Jehovah's everlasting covenant. And just pray with me right now. Say, Father.
Father.
Give me. A spirit.
A spirit.
Of wisdom.
Of wisdom.
And revelation.
Revelation.
Hallelujah. I don't have it in your notes, but I'll go ahead and just read our scripture tonight. From Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 and 21, it says, "And the God of peace, who brought up our master Yeshua from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect." Say, I'm perfect.
I'm perfect.
In the blood of the everlasting covenant.
In the blood of the everlasting covenant.
In every good work to do his desire working in you, what is pleasing in his sight, through Yeshua, Messiah, to whom be esteem and glory forever and forever. So we've been looking in this series at the everlasting covenant, the covenant that we have with God, that if the heavens roll back like a scroll, the earth stops spinning underneath our feet, we do not have to fear, because the creator of all things,
Amen.
If your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven, then he is in authority, as Mark was saying on first day, or on Sabbath, and we don't have to be afraid, amen?
That's right.
So we're looking at the days that we are living in, and in the days to come. Some things that the Holy Spirit has been talking to me about some of the basis for the lie of the deception of the enemy that the Antichrist or the Antichrist spirit is laying right now in our world. And if you're like me, you probably operate in little Christian circles, and you may not get out of that a lot. You may not go to academia a lot and go into, how many have been to astronomy conferences lately? You been to any of those? Or naval astronomy? You know, we just don't go in those circles. So the Holy Spirit's been showing me some things along with some other people and taking to me to some sources from people that have done a lot more work than I have. Exposing some of the root of the lie of the Antichrist spirit that he is going to be laying out and is already laying out in the days that we live in. And so we started introducing that to you guys last week in this teaching by looking at the two roots, say roots, for the creation account. Okay, so let's just read our review here. In modern thought, there are two main root sources affecting how man views creation. The scriptural Hebraic account that creation itself and the scriptures testify to. And then there's a second one that is gaining momentum in academia, in politics, in religious circles all around the world. And that is the Sumerian account. And we introduced that to you last week. You can go back and watch the video or get the notes, which we will see has actually shaped the aim of current astrology and national space programs today. One of the things that's just, you know, very easy to see if you just go on some space sites, space.com is one that you can go on. And I just went on space.com and took two of a multiplicity of recent articles listed on their heading. They have a heading in the top of the space.com site called Search for Life. And they are very focused. They are spending millions of your tax dollars right now looking for life in other planets, in other regions, in other galaxies. Why? Because they believe there is other life that has been seeded or that exists there that affects why we're here. And so they're literally spilling millions of tax dollars. Our government is looking and investigating for this. So they have two articles that were just listed on top. One was called "The Hunt for Intelligent Aliens Should Focus on the Transit Zone." And that article is dated 3/1/16. The other one was "Eyeing Exomoons in the Search for ET." That was put up in February 19, 16. So this is not some subterranean rumor going through our culture, but this is in mainstream. And we need to know it's gaining momentum. And the Holy Spirit has just led me to several things, and I'll just bring it out as we go through the series about what the enemy is planning on doing with this information. Next paragraph. The Sumerian historical account, unlike Darwinism, that has no absolute provable missing link to to evolution, has archaeological evidence of some 2,000, which is more like 30,000, cuneiform tablets alone. Now, I just want to, you know, when you look and you study Darwinism and evolution, one of the biggest problems they have is finding that evidence of that missing link of where, you know, that frog made that jump to an ape or then to a person or however they do their little thing there. And that's a big problem for them. And one of the things that you need to understand in the future when you're having dialogue with people about this is that, unlike Darwinianism, when you talk about the Sumerian tablets, all over the world, and I've got a video in a couple of weeks I'm going to show you guys, it's just incredible, but all over the world, there is ancient evidence that the enemy, I believe, is seated in every ancient culture that stem from this root of this Sumerian false creation account. It's involved in the crop circles when you look at them, and the evidence of what's going on. Again, I'll show you some stuff on that. But it's evidence in the large megalithic temples and structures that are all over the world, in the cuneiforms, in the Egyptian hieroglyphics, in the Babylonians, in the Phoenicians. They all merge together because they all have that separate root. And we need to realize there's not just going to be some ape man that pops up as a human. They have actual hardcore stuff that they're going to be bringing out, along with the supernatural feats of the false prophet, who the Bible says is going to do the works of Satan and draw down fire from heaven and do supernatural acts, supernatural signs and displays in the heavenlies, that if you do not know your God, your covenant, and what it teaches about creation, the Bible says it's going to be so deceptive that if it was even possible, the elect, and that's us, could be deceived. Right. And I just want to give Father glory right now. I have had the best time in the past few days. God's had me learning some stuff. I've been reading another thick book for us, and I'm going to be bringing out some information. I am more pumped about the coming back of Yeshua than I have ever been in my whatever years of Christianity. I'm just telling you, it is so awesome. And there's some tweaks that the Holy Spirit is giving that I'm going to put before us for us to judge that are, it's just amazing. But I'm telling you, our redemption is drawing nigh, and it's awesome. But you need to know, they have got some hardcore stuff. You go to the British Museum right now, you go in, you're going to see some hardcore stuff. Plus, behind the scenes, there are principalities and authorities that are suppressing the evidence of God, creation, in the Old Testament accounts in the scripture. That's why I put a documentary recommendation for you guys to watch a few months ago, called Patterns of Evidence, where they have screwed up the timeline of Moses coming out of Egypt and under the wrong Pharaoh. And when you do, all of the evidence goes away of Jericho, of any of that thing. But when you move it in the proper timeline, everything lines up perfectly. And we actually have that DVD. We're going to be putting it in the supply, or you can rent it and watch it. It's called Patterns of Evidence, and it's an awesome documentary to watch. But there has been a cover-up on this planet of God. But we're the evidence. We're the witnesses. And when the two witnesses supernaturally show up in Jerusalem that they can't kill or shut up, and then the Ark of the Covenant possibly revealed by the two witnesses, I'm telling you, God is not going to be outdone. And I hear a hallelujah. But we need to know this just so we're ready to deal with this, because the Holy Spirit is teaching us this, so we're following Him. But they do have these evidence. They have tattooed over 20 to 30,000 tablets alone. Some of those they got out with Saddam Hussein when we went into Iraq. Some of this stuff they say they went in and got out. So it's interesting. But anyway, along with the reproduction of a counterfeit mythology, and I say counterfeit because they copied the original chicken sandwich, with charter, with character name changes, though most of all ancient civilization creation mythos, which are just their myths, their mythologies. This mounts up to a lot of ancient evidence that may well be the seed for the lie of deception that will be laid out in the last days. And I just picked out a couple things that I mean to write on here. This is for educational purposes, for copyright, but because that's legal. But if you look here at this first picture that you have here, this is one of the Sumerian tablets and the pictures that they have preserved. And if you notice the guy sitting there on the chair, if he stood up, he would be a little taller than the guys coming to him. He's representative as one of the Anunnaki gods. And he's giving him a plow. He's giving him a tool because they say the sun gods came down and they gave them knowledge on how to do things, like the Watcher teaching in the book of Enoch. So he's giving them plow, and then you notice the two men coming to him. In between the two men, if you can see, there's like a solar system that is there. So he's giving them planetary understanding of what's going on, and there's some other things you can get into with that particular one. But to the right is what you might find in the British Museum if you went and looked there at what the cuneiforms and what they say. A guy named Zachariah Sitchin did like four books several years ago, and we'll get into some of his research and actually decoded this stuff for them. What I want to do right now, because I was real tempted just to jump and keep going, but I really felt led by the Holy Spirit to be sure we got a really good foundation. So if you have your notes from last week, and if you weren't here last week and you didn't get them, they're still over here. It's 3/16/16 would be the date for those particular notes, and you're welcome to get up and get one if you need to. But we stopped last week at letter K in those notes, and if you've got those with you, turn back, or if you need to get one, you're welcome to. And we're going to pick up, because as we were talking about with this creation evidence, it's so important that we understand what all of our scripture says about creation, not just Genesis 1. And a lot of times when you talk about creation, you say, oh yeah, that's Genesis 1. It's in the prophets. It's in the wisdom literature. There are things about creation scattered all through our scriptures. And one of the things we're going to do is take those and put them together and look at a little bit bigger picture of what it's saying to do that. But if you can undermine creation and who created us and in whose image we were created, you can undermine the entire scripture. So it's really important that we have our foundation. And this was the premise and the argument that Paul was bringing out here in the book of Romans in chapter 1. And let's just read verses 20 through 21. It says, "For since the creation of the world," so notice he's talking about creation here, "his invisible qualities have been clearly seen." Now, how many of you know that stars in the sky and planetary bodies are a little bit bigger evidence than a cuneiform tablet written in clay some 6,000 years ago? Amen? So if you want some evidence of God and his creation, creation itself is evidence to that. "Being understood from what has been made, both his everlasting power and mightiness, for them to be without excuse." In other words, everyone who dies, and it's appointed every man to die, and then what? The judgment. You're going to be without excuse that there is a God. You could be in blah blah country in the blah blah woods, never heard the gospel, but if you look up and you see creation and think there must be a God, and you reach out to him to the extent that you know, the Bible says where there is no law, there's no accountability for that. If you're reaching out for God, and that's what the book of Romans is about in later on. So he's setting the thing here, though, saying you don't have excuse not to believe in God and not to believe in a creator. Verse 21, "Because although they," now there are people that know this, but they misuse that knowledge, and that's what he begins to talk about. "Because although they knew God, they did not esteem him as the mighty one," as Elohim, "nor did they give thanks to him as their creator, but became vain in their reasonings, and their undiscerning heart was darkened." So this scripture shows us that if we reject God as our creator, and we say, no, I was not created by Jehovah, I was not created by God, I am not his image in the earth, then what's going to be the response of that in our lives is that we are going to become vain in our reasoning. Our reasoning is not going to be able to make sense. It's going to become empty. It's going to become futile. And you know, sometimes you look at people in academia or politicians who have denied God as creator. I believe it was the Democratic Party two times ago that took God out of their party platform because they didn't want him to be a part of their party anymore. He was probably relieved, but anyway. Sorry, it could be a big splash there. But when you begin to deny God as creator, there is a vainness that comes in your reasoning ability.
Come on.
And sometimes you look at people and they're making these decisions and you're like, why? Are they? It doesn't even make sense when you know the truth. The reason there's a vanity that becomes in their mind. What's another translation on that? The end part of verse 21.
Futile
in their thinking. Anybody else got another word?
It says their foolish hearts were darkened.
Senseless. Boy, that puts it out there. They become senseless. They just don't have sense. And then their discerning heart was darkened. When you reject God as creator, you become subject to vain, senseless thinking. And to having your heart darkened where you can't understand the truth or hear the truth. Now, I want to say on the plus side of that, that is why in the New Testament, we are encouraged to pray for the blinders that are on people's eyes to be removed. Don't be praying, God save Uncle John. God has already saved Uncle John. He did that 2,000 years ago on the cross. What we need to pray is for Uncle John's eyes to be open to the gospel and for the demonic interference that's keeping him from seeing the truth to be removed. And we've seen more effectiveness in that type of prayer than just that prayer, save Uncle John. Well, Uncle John's already saved. God's already done that part. Now, we've just got to pray what's binding that off and give him an opportunity to hear without demonic interference the gospel. And then he has a clear choice to make that. Amen?
Amen?
All right. So we need to realize for rejecting God as creator, there is huge ramifications. And we have already begun to see them if you read the rest of this text in our nation. But now what I want you to do is back up and read verse 17 of this chapter, because this is the premise for God as creator. It says, for in it the righteousness of Elohim, or of God, is revealed. You have to have a revelation here. From belief to belief, as it has been written in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 4, but the righteous shall live by faith, or shall live by belief. Do you know faith is preached in the Old Covenant? That the righteous live by faith. Abraham chose to live by faith and not by sight. Habakkuk lived by faith and not by sight. If you're going to have believe God as your creator, it must be revealed to you by faith. Because you either have faith or you don't have faith. And I tell you, I've been reading some academic Christian books by Christian scholars, and I get so tired of them sometimes because they just can't say what they want to say nicely or just put it out there. They have to do this side of the argument and this side of the argument, and this might be right. And if I'm wrong here, then maybe this. And they know a lot, but I want to know what they believe. I want to know what God has revealed to them, and it's good to go through all that and to weigh all that. But I've got a question for you tonight. Do you believe what you know?
Come on.
Because we can know a lot, but you're not going to die for what you know. You're going to die for what you believe. And we have a lot of people walking around with a lot of knowledge and information, but what do you believe? Right. The righteous have a revelation of God and his righteousness, and when you do, you live by belief. You live by faith. Letter L. This is the key. Notice that scripture always points to understanding Jehovah as our creator. This is the essential foundation to understanding him, to understanding his ways, to understanding our own purpose, and to keep us from becoming those who have undiscerning hearts that become darkened. Letter M, if you do not have the revealed Jehovah creation account in you as the foundation of your heart, you will be subject to the deception that will be released in the last days. And I know we have covered this in lessons in the past, but it's not been on YouTube, and it just does good to go over it again. So turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 9. This is two books, 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians, that Paul wrote to new believers. And can you believe when he was writing to new believers, he was teaching them about end times? Oh, Why? People say, well, you don't need to know that stuff. Yes, you do. Even 2,000 years ago, Apostle Paul thought it was important for new believers to have the understanding of what the Bible teaches about Yeshua coming back. Yeah. Why? It causes you to live in soberness. It causes you to live with fervency. It causes you to live watching and waiting for Him. Okay, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, let's just start with verse 8. It says, and then the lawless one that is known as the Antichrist shall be revealed, whom the master shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and bring to naught with the manifestation of his coming. So what does that mean? When Yeshua shows up, it's over. All right, the shofar has sounded, and that's better than when the fat lady sings. Verse 9, yes. The coming of the lawless one or of the Antichrist is according to the working of Satan with all power and with signs and wonders of falsehood and with all deceit of unrighteousness in those perishing because they did not receive the love of the truth, because they did not acknowledge God as his, as their creator, because they did not acknowledge the scripture, the truth of scripture is the infallible word of God. Because they rejected that, they are open to this deception. And then it says, in order for them, they don't receive the truth so that they can be saved. Verse 11, and for this reason, and I'm just telling you what, as you're witnessing to people in your daily lives right now, you need to let them know this scripture. Do you realize if you reject the truth of the gospel, oh, I don't have to make a decision today. Oh, it's you know, it's not. No, the Bible says if you don't accept Yeshua Messiah, if you don't have a revelation of God, if you don't have a revelation of the word of God as your creator, then you will be given a spirit of delusion and you will believe and go down the tubes with the rest of the world. That's how important it is not to procrastinate, not to put it off. And there needs to be an urgency for people to believe, and there needs to be an urgency for us to share it with people, for them to believe, because eternity is a what? Long time.
That's right.
Verse 11, and for this reason, why? They rejected the truth. They heard the gospel. They heard that God was their creator. They had those encounters with God because God speaks to everyone. And over the past 2 years, there's been a major prophet in the world that got up and shared in the conference I was listening to that God has sent every financial head in this world to preach the gospel to them, to give them an opportunity to repent from the voices and the fallen spirits that they are listening to. Our God is a merciful God, and He always gives you a chance to repent and to listen and to hear and know the truth. Verse 11, and for this reason, Elohim sends them a working of delusion for them to believe the falsehood or the lie. And so what I believe the Holy Spirit is revealing to me and revealing to others is that there is a seed, an ancient seed for this lie that Satan and the fallen ones planted in civilization centuries ago, preparing for this time. Now, is God undone? Is He nervous about it? Is He upset? No. But do you believe if we pray for secrets that God will reveal them to us?
Absolutely.
You know, our pastor or apostle in this house right now has this praying from Daniel that God would reveal secrets to us. Well, I'm about to share some, and are you going to believe them? If He tells you a secret, will you believe it?
Amen.
That's right.
If He tells you a secret, will you believe it? It's one thing to pray. It's another thing. Oh, I've never thought that. I don't know that. You need to weigh it with the counsel of the word, weigh it with the spirit, share it one another, weigh it. But if you pray for secrets, you best be expecting some.
Yeah, that's right.
And when you get one, pray tell, what are you going to do with it? Turn to Revelation chapter 4. Why do we worship God? Why do we come in here on Sabbath and lift our hands and worship Him? Does He need that? Does He have a bad day? Nobody worships Him?
Yeah.
Why do we worship Him? Because He is worthy of worship. Revelation chapter 4, It's amazing, all the focus of God as creator in the book of Revelation, and that's a telltale sign that's going to be the area, one of the main areas the enemy attacks. Revelation chapter 4, look at verse 7. This is John's revelation of around the throne. It says, and the first living creature, these were creatures created by God, was like a lion, and the second living creature was like a calf, and the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle, and the four living creatures, each having six wings, were covered with eyes around and within. And they do not cease, day or night, saying, set apart, set apart, set apart, or holy, 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 Jehovah, El Shaddai, who was, and who is, and who is coming.
Yeah.
And when the living creatures give esteem and respect and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and forever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne, and they bow before him who lives forever and ever, and they cast their crowns before the throne, and they say this, notice verse 11, you are worthy, O Jehovah, to receive esteem and glory, respect and power. Why? Why? For you have created all. Say it with me. You have created all. And because of your desire.
Yes.
Barbara, you're here tonight because God desired you. Clay, you're here because God desired you. Alan, you're here because God desired you. We need somebody that can fix everything. Hallelujah. Because God desires us. I mean, we could just sit here tonight and just stop and just go into this waiting prayer and just do waiting prayer. You desired me.
That's good.
I mean, you could spend a week journaling on, God, what does it mean that you desired me? I don't care if you were a one-night stand or you were a product of rape or however you came into this world, a loving relationship, whether you know your mother or father, whether you don't, it does not matter in the eternal sense that you were desired a father, the creator of all, and that is why you are here.
So be it. Yeah.
That is why we were created. And this glorious foundation, this glorious truth is the bedrock that we live, that we stand on. And this is where the enemy desires to erode. I'm not going to turn there. Mark went to it on Sabbath, but Psalm chapter 25, verses 12 through 14, it talks about God revealing his covenant to people who fear him.
Come on.
And when I read that a couple of weeks ago, the Holy Spirit said the covenant has to be revealed. And do you mind if I share? Miss Cheryl said, as an encouraging text where she'd written in her journal like over a year ago.
What was Christmas?
Several months ago. Yeah. About the covenant being revealed. And we need to be praying for ourselves. Father, reveal your covenant to me. Let's just do that. Father, reveal your covenant to me. And we need to be praying that over other people. If you're sharing restorations of truth that God is bringing us into as a body here at Hunters Point Celebration Center, the restoration of Passover instead of worshiping a fertility goddess and a bunny that lays eggs in your yard, if we're worshiping the dedication of the temple back to God rather than the wrong person's birthday, if we're being restored back into knowing his name, knowing his ways, it is different. It's a restoration. Hopefully we're going to get to that a little bit later in our notes. But you need to pray. If the Lord prompts you to share that with someone, pray. God, give them a revelation of your covenant. And how many of you know, we don't know all his ways yet, right? They're higher brothers. We need to pray that over ourselves. God, give us a revelation, especially those of us that have been raised in a Greek culture. I mean, everything's Greek, and now we're trying to live Hebrew in a Greek world, and it's kind of like, you know, you're just trying to figure all that out. There's a lot to it, but the Holy Spirit is restoring the identity to the bride, because when Yeshua shows up in the clouds. He's going to be a Jewish rabbi king, and he's looking for his bride that has his identity. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. So we're not going to get into all that, but let's go ahead and just read letter P, because it leads into where we're going. Next page. The reason Jehovah chose to pass down the creation account versus all these ancient cuneiform tablets that predate what we would call the Mosaic Law. The reason Jehovah chose to pass down the creation account and his ways from Adam to Moses down through the generations, tell your children, as the intellectual world calls it, the oral tradition, okay? That word just feels so stiff to me, okay? This is our oral tradition. No, it's more than that. And when I was meditating on that, I believe the Holy Spirit said, I was asking, Father, why did you do it this way? You could have just given a big old rock and chiseled it with Adam in the garden, and he could have passed that rock over to, you know, let me get the right one. Seth, thank you. I always get my S's messed up. He could have passed it on, but he waited all the way to Moses, you know, to give that written. Why did he do it that way? And I believe he spoke to me and said, it is because he has always intended his covenant to be communicated heart to heart and face to face.
It's good.
You know, I have loved, and so many times as parents, I know we feel like we fall short, but I've loved those times in my home with my own child, where I've had those moments where we connect. And I'm passing down that heritage of what God has given. And you know that there's light bulbs coming on that end, and then there's light bulbs coming on this end. But that passing down, there's nothing like that personal discipleship. And if you look at the way, read the book of Deuteronomy, it's tell this to your children. Even when you do the Passover feast, when your children say, why is this night like no other night? Tell them, we were slaves, bondaged in Israel, or Egypt, but God came down. He's always focused on sharing. You look at the New Testament, Yeshua, you know, he didn't just come out with 5 million books and give it to the disciples and say, read this and you'll be okay. No, it was that heart-to-heart time.
Right.
It was that face-to-face time. What did he say? Go into all the world and educate them. He said, go into all the world and what? Disciple. Face to face. Heart to heart. Why? Because that's our papa.
Right.
Last night in waiting prayer, and one of the things that just really struck me, and I think John wrote some stuff out about it too that was phenomenal last night, but just seeking out for the face of God. Mm-hmm. When was the last time you prayed, God, I want to see your face? Well, can we do that? Well, then why did David write in the Psalms where it says, the Lord says, seek my face, and I say, your face, oh God, will I seek.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
If you saw Yeshua, would you know what he looked like? Mm-hmm. Have you spent enough time looking for him, seeking him, saying, show me what you look like? If you walked in a room, would you recognize him? There should be something in your heart that wants that.
That's right.
That's our right. It's our privilege. And it's a journey. But God wants to teach us face to face and heart to heart. Letter Q. At Mount Sinai, when Jehovah God came down himself to heart to heart and face to face with a little demonstration going on to get their attention, communicate his covenant with Israel, who had just been birthed into a set apart nation out of Egypt. And he desired to make them a nation of royal priests, of which we are now part of that nation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But this new nation of Israel refused his personal invitation, and Moses received the Torah as a mediator on their behalf. But God's heart was what? Come here. Thunder, lightning, shofars in the heavens. I mean, it was intense. But God was gone, coming down. And on when he was coming down, he was saying, I want to show you who I am. I want you to see your Father who desired you. And I want to give this covenant to you, not through a mediator. That wasn't his original heart. He wanted to give it face to face and heart to heart.
That's right.
But so many times we freak out and we reject that personal relationship. Not too long ago, I was having a quiet time at home, and I was just really seeking the Lord and set apart a whole time just to really seek after him and just crying out for more vision, crying out to see more and hear more. And all of a sudden, I had this fact, I was here. I was in room 101, 103, and I'd set out a whole day just to seek the Lord, crying out for more vision and being able to hear Him better. And I had all of a sudden goosebumps. You know how you get that? And it's like you just know you're not in the room by yourself anymore. And I just had this feeling that like He was just about to pop out, you know? And I was just saying, okay, wait a minute. I don't know if I'm ready. I did. Even as much as I've seen Him in the Spirit, to see Him openly is like a whole different deal. You know what I'm saying? And so I was like, wait a minute. And God just so undid me at that moment. Because I realized, as much as I was seeking after Him, there was still a level of fear, insecurity, or anything there. And I had to spend time saying, God, what was that? Where'd that come from? Why was I afraid of You? You know? And, I mean, here's God coming down. And, angels and sapphire floor and all this, you know. And they're like, I don't know if I'm ready for this. Moses, you go. But God wanted to speak heart to heart and face to face.
He does.
Letter U. This covenant dictated, you can say, to Moses at Sinai, who came out of the schools of Egypt, Babylon, Babylonian, Sumerian roots, included the original account of creation to set the creation record straight, to preserve it for future generations. And that's where we're going to go as we just continue to look at Moses for a little bit longer tonight in our notes. So turn back to your notes for tonight. And let's pick up here with letter A. And before we get into analyzing, looking for revelation over all the creation accounts in our scripture, I really felt led today that God wants us to really get a little more grounded on how Moses received the creation account. How he received the creation account. So letter A on our notes for tonight, everybody say hallelujah. Cookies are coming. We're having cookies in a minute, so just hang in there, okay? Wake you up a little bit. How Moses received the creation account, letter A. The book of Exodus in our English Bible means going out. When you see Exodus, that's what it means. But did you know that the original Hebrew name for this book is not Exodus? And it's not going out? Does anybody know what it is? It's right there in your notes. But it's Shemoth. I believe I'm saying that right. All right, Shemoth. Shem in the Hebrew language means name. Shemoth is plural, and it means names. So the second book in the Bible is actually called Names. Say Names.
Names.
Actually, if you turn in your scripture, and you can because we're going to be there a little while, turn to Exodus and just look at chapter 1 and verse 1, and this makes sense. And these are the names of the children of Israel who came to Egypt with Jacob, each one with his household. So it starts with, these are the names, and the original Hebrew name for this book is called the Names, or just Names. I did not take the time to chase down where that got changed or why that got changed, and that would be an interesting little trick if you ever want to do that, but it was changed. That's why you have the word Hashem. Say Hashem.
Hashem.
If you're talking to a messianic believer or someone who's trained that they can't say the name, like a Pharisee, if you talk with them, even in modern day, they will say Hashem instead of the name of God because they believe that you're not to pronounce it. So they'll say Hashem in Hebrew, which is used in reference to God's name, means the name. Ha means the. So the name Hashem. Now it's interesting that the book of Exodus's name was changed because in Exodus chapter 3:15, God reveals His what? Name to Moses as Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, Jehovah. And it's used in Genesis 2 for the first time in our scripture, but it's not revealed until Moses here in chapter 3. So if the name of God, the creator of all, is going to be revealed in a book, might be good to call it the names. And it might be a lot of Hebrew wordplay. If you know anything about Hebrew language, they love wordplay and puns and secret codes and messages. It's like incredible how it's encoded in that. But so this is not just one of the descriptive titles such as Lord, which in Hebrew is Adonai, or Mighty One, which in Hebrew is Elohim or God, but His name, as in our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. God has a name. And we did a whole series on that that you can listen to called Restoring the Name of Yehovah, the Exalted Name of Yehovah. And I've been looking for an opportunity to fit this in, so today I'm going to just go over this real quick. And there's some resources here you can pull from, but the pronunciation of Yod Heh Vav Heh, the four tetragrammaton letters that make the name of God, as Yahweh, sometimes you hear it pronounced Yahweh, sometimes you hear it pronounced Jehovah. This is a quote from the Anchor Bible Dictionary from Friedman, but it says, the pronunciation of Yod Heh Vav Heh as Yahweh is a scholarly guess. All right, and this is why they say that. This is taken from the Kimia Gordon. He's a language specialist, graduated from the Hebrew University there in Israel. He worked on the Dead Sea Scrolls, and I pulled some stuff from him. And he has a website called AkaraiteCorner.org. Akarite is a born natural Jew, who wants to live according to Torah and not just on all the rabbi laws that they add on to the Torah. Okay, so it's much in the line that we are. He's just coming at it from the Jewish side, where we're coming at it from being a part of the nations and trying to come. But we both end up in Yeshua as one. Amen? Mm-hmm. All right. So this is a quote from him that was in a book I list later. But it says, those scholars who say his name is Yahweh base their argument on information from sources outside the actual Hebrew text. Their primary source is Theodoret, which I may not be pronouncing correctly, Theodoret of Cyrus, a church father who lived in the 5th century CE, who wrote the following concerning the name Yod Heh Vav Heh. The Samaritans call him Iabe. The ancient Samaritans called the creator Yahweh, meaning the beautiful one. As a result, most scholars convert the Samaritan Abe or Yahweh back to the Hebrew as Yahweh. So that's where they get that. It's outside of the Hebrew text in itself, and it comes from a Samaritan root, which they were kind of mixed anyway. But if I'm in a worship service, just as a side note, and they're singing a song in Yahweh, I'll say Yahweh. I just know what I'm saying is the beautiful one. I'm ascribing to him, and how many of us can believe God is the beautiful one, okay?
Absolutely.
So if they're singing Yahweh, I don't have a problem with that. We just need to know that's not from a strict Hebrew delineation of the root of the word. Now, there's a lot more about this, but I just wanted to lay this out there, and I give you a source you can look at, but let's look at the next point here. According to Gordon, quote, the scholarly assumption that Yod Heh Vav Heh is the, and he gives two verbs here, the P-I-E-L or the H-I-F-I-L form of the H-Y-H, which means to be, is impossible since this verb does not exist in those conjunctions. Now notice this next sentence. In other words, according to biblical Hebrew, Yahweh is a non-existent verbal form. So if you read Hebrew, you don't find the way in a verb form. Now, I'm trekking through a lot of intellectual stuff and summarizing it here. You're welcome to trek it yourself if you want. But this really made sense to me, this next thing that he brought out in this book, but it's a reference here. But supportive evidence for this in the Hebrew language for people like us who don't read Hebrew can simply be seen by here. There are no people in the Hebrew Bible that have names with Yod-Heh pronounced Yah as a prefix. There are, on the other hand, many names with Yah or Yehovah, as a suffix, such as Yeshua, or I'm not going to try to say the Hebrew names here, but as Isaiah. Does it say Isaiah or Isaiah? Mm-hmm. Okay, Elijah. Does it say Elijah or Elijah, Eliway? You kind of get the point. Does it say Jeremiah way? This is Jeremiah, all right? And then you have Zedekiah, not Zedekiah-way, or Zedekiah-way. So, I don't read Hebrew. I don't confess to be a Hebrew scholar. But if you just look in your Bibles, there's no ways as vowels. Also, Blue Letter Bible, you take the capital L-O-R-D, punch on it, look up in the interlinear dictionary, it says right there, Yehovah. Original King James Bible front page, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, they knew what it was. They took his name out because King Jamie told them to, okay? So there's a book that I have that we want to get in the supply called His Hallowed Name Revealed Again by Keith Johnson. And this particular section here is taken from pages 136 to 143 of that book. He quotes Nehemiah. Nehemiah is his best friend, helps him learn Hebrew, read Hebrew. He's learned Hebrew, Keith has himself, and studied it out and found the two times in the Hebrew Bible where the vowels, the priest, the scribes left the vowels in the Hebrew language so we would know how to pronunciate it. They snuck it around. So it got in there, and he can show you in the book where it is, and it's just amazing, you know, to do that. But in the book of Exodus is where God's name is revealed. So it's called names, and God's name is revealed there. Letter B. Shemoth is the plural of the word Shem, and Shem means name, and was the son of Noah who fathered the Shemites, from whom the Messiah came, from the line of Shem. You see that in Genesis 6 through 10. The Shemites included the Akkadians. Now, I'm just mentioning this too, because when you go to look some of this stuff, you start researching, you got the Sumerians, you got the Akkadians, you got the Shemites, they're all next door neighbors, and how do they relate? Okay, so the Shemites included the Akkadians and spread out in northern Mesopotamia, northern Iraqish area, okay, and held the original creation account from Jehovah. They carried that from Adam through Noah through Shem. They carried that original creation account. History records them as Semites. Notice there's no H there. It would be better if they'd have called them Shemites. You could, but you just need to know when you're reading, not in the scripture, but historically, you're talking about the Israelites were Semitic people. What on earth does that mean? That means they were from the descendants of Shem. Okay? They come through that. All right? Shemites. The Semitic people, that region and area. Now, it's interesting that Nimrod in Babylon was attempting to make a new Shem. Notice this first, Genesis 11:4. This is the Tower of Babel. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city, a tower whose top is in the heavens, and make a name. That word in the Hebrew is Shem. We're going to make our own Shem. We're going to make our own line through which our own Messiah will come from. And they did. And he will soon be revealed in the world at some point as the Antichrist. For ourselves, lest we be scattered over all the face of the earth. Genesis 11:14. Letter C. Over the centuries, Noah's descendants began to assimilate into the Sumerians. So up at the north, you had the Shemites, and you had the Akkadians, and you had the Sumerians down here, and they all began to conquer one another and to interbreed, to tribal marry, and so they became one big melting pot. So Noah's descendants began to assimilate into the Sumerians. That's why we found Abram there, and Babylonians, and many began to forget the ancient account of creation and instead began to fall into the superstition and idolatry of the culture. But Jehovah God always has a remnant. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
And that's why we read the story of Jasher and Abram, how God kept him, raised him with Noah and Shem, and got the true account and the true ways of God to him. God always has that remnant carrying that truth. Mm-hmm. That is why it is necessary, and that's why I just told you to know that. There are those all over the earth right now that are a part of the marvelous restoration of Jehovah and his ways until the full restoration of all things comes that is talked about in Acts chapter 3, verse 21. And this, do you get that? We may at the Sabbath, at the Shabbat meal at Miss Cheryl and Brent's on Friday night, we may play a great movie we have on Martin Luther. You know, that reformer that found out salvation by faith. You don't have to buy a relic. Amen? You can get saved by faith and restored that to the body. There's been levels of restoration. James is about to go out to California and Azuzu, 100 years celebration where that baptism of the Holy Spirit was restored. There's been restoration. Sometimes I don't think we get it because we're living in it. But there is an awakening and a restoration of the ways of Jehovah going on across the planet. Mm-hmm. And I'm just thankful and amazed to be a part of that, about what God is doing. But listen, Moses was equally a part of that in his generation. And I want you to think about Mount Sinai and what happens with him there as a restoration that began to be revealed, a restoration of things in the earth. Because the account of creation and the ways of God had gotten so mixed by the time of Israel coming out of Egypt that God is going to come down and set the record straight. Letter D, this is what was happening with Moses as well. An interesting question is in the book of Names, are we ever given, oh this was interesting, Moses' Hebrew name. Think about that for a minute. He is given his name in Exodus chapter 2 verse 10 by an Egyptian princess, we all know the story, that draws him out of the water, so she calls him drawn out of the water. So what is that his Hebrew name or is that his Egyptian name? I don't really have an answer to that. If you want to chase it, it's kind of fun. But do we know his Hebrew name? You know, Esther, this starts Purim tonight. Esther is not her Hebrew name. What's her Hebrew name? Hadassah. And I've got some notes for that in your handout. But she's called Esther, which is Venus. The Babylonian goddess, Semiramis. Was who they changed her name to. So I don't celebrate Esther, I celebrate Hadassah. Hallelujah. So in fact, look at this. Are you still in Exodus? Look at chapter 2, verse 1. This is talking about Moses' mom and dad. Look at this. And a man of the house of Levi went and married a daughter of Levi. What's their names? Interesting. There's so much interplay in the book of Exodus with names. You might want to reread it and ask the Holy Spirit to show you. I believe one of the things that I read a rabbi's dissertation or teaching on this, they said that the absence of names suggests here in this verse how dehumanizing life in Egypt had become. That they had no rights, no agency, no freedom, and no identity. Wow. And that's one of the reasons why they said a man who was a Levite and a woman had a baby. And we're not even given a Hebrew name. We're just given the name Moses, which maybe the mother gave the name, the backstory, I don't know. But it's just something interesting to think about. Letter E. The God of Moses that he met on Mount Sinai was greater than all the gods of the Egyptian mythos. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
All right, so all these Sumerian cuneiforms and all the stuff that they have. Show me any clay tablet you want, but my God still whipped their butts. Show me the Epic of Gilgamesh. Show me the Enlil Elish or whatever their ancient Sumerian thing, and we'll look into some of that in the future. Just show it to me, but the fact of the matter is, show me who's drowned in the Red Sea, all right? It wasn't Israel, okay? All right. The horse and rider was thrown into the sea, just like God showed Nimrod in his dream in Jasher. And he will again, in our generation, prove faithful to those who trust in him in our day. Hallelujah.
Glory.
All right. I think we're going to stop right there tonight. Letter F. We're going to get to where God actually gives the creation account to Moses. And we need to have a good basis for that. So, any questions or comments about where we are?
You said we need to know that we are created specifically by God because He loves us. In Anna Mendez, in her book, Regions of Captivity, this is a beginning to be revelation knowledge for me, is that so many people are in captivity, and the name of the principality over that captivity has no value, or is worthless, has no worth. We're calling people out of an identity. And this whole evolution says has no worth. So that is, I'm beginning to think, and I know that my household is in captivity under the members of my household. I'm beginning to get discernment. To begin, I have to break that. And then I've got to seek that breaking over my household.
Yeah, that's one of the interesting thing about the whole Sumerian. If you remember the picture on the front page there, you've got the god and the little guys coming to him for the plow. They basically were gods. And in their account, we were created as a slave class to work the gold mines and to work for them. So would you rather have a creator that created you to be their slave? Or would you rather have a creator that says, you're made in my image, you rule and reign with me, and imparts dignity and value? So it's interesting. And talk about principalities. On the last page, page 5 of your handout, 5 and 6, you can just read through that if you want to, for Purim. But, you know, it was just really striking to me, if you see the picture there of the missile that was launched on March 9th from Iran. And they wrote on the missile in Hebrew, Israel must be wiped out. And you know, John, you're talking about principalities. The principality that was in Haman did not die with Haman.
That's right.
The principality that hates Israel, that hates God's people, they're still shooting rockets at them today, trying to kill them. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's just interesting that God is coming, and everything that thinks it's a God that's not a God is going to be judged, bow its knee, and we're going to turn the page and start fresh. Hallelujah.
Glory.
And that's a good thing.
Glory.